Polled is a term used to refer to goats, sheep, cattle, or other livestock that naturally do not grow horns. This trait is genetic and works a bit differently in each species. The polled trait can be very beneficial to livestock producers, as animals that can't grow horns don't have to be disbudded. There are considered to be two types of polled: giraffe polled and smooth polled. Giraffe polled is when tiny horn buds appear but do not break the skin, and smooth polled is when these buds do not appear at all. It is unknown how many genes are involved in this and how exactly they work. Regardless, both are considered to be polled as they result in the lack of horn growth. In this video, we'll be going over the genetics of polled goats, including six different Punnett squares related to the breeding of polled and horned goats. Before we begin, I'd like to clarify a few misconceptions regarding the polled allele and the genetics of polled goats. Firstly, in goats, the polled allele, as well as the horned allele, are autosomal. This means that they are not sex-linked, and therefore has an equal chance of passing to the offspring, regardless of whether the dam or sire is polled. For those of you that don't know, the word dam refers to the mother, and the word sire refers to the father. Secondly, when I mention horned goats, I don't mean goats that actually have horns. The action of disbudding, which is burning the undeveloped horn bud in young goats, just eliminates the horns from going. However, that does not make a goat polled. A goat is only considered polled if it naturally does not have horns due to its genotype or its genetics. Before we continue, I want to go over a few quick terms that I will be using a lot in this video. The first is the term homozygous. A goat, or any other living thing, is homozygous for a trait if it has identical or the same alleles at a particular gene locus on homologous chromosomes. For example, for a goat to be horned, it must be homozygous for the horned allele. The next term is heterozygous, which means that the goat has two different alleles for the same gene. For example, a goat that is heterozygous for the polled trait is one that has one horned allele and one polled allele. We will take a look at some Punnett square diagrams to visualize that in a minute. The last terms are the words genotype and phenotype. A genotype is the genetic makeup, whereas the phenotype is the outward appearance. Finally, let's take a look at the genetics of polled goats. The polled gene follows the rules for simple dominance, meaning a goat will be polled regardless of whether it is homozygous or heterozygous for the polled allele. As mentioned before, the polled allele is autosomal, which means it has an equal chance of passing to the offspring, regardless of whether the dam or sire is polled. The gene symbol for the polled allele is a capital P. The gene symbol for the horned allele is a lowercase p. Keep in mind that the polled allele is capitalized because the polled allele is dominant to the horned allele. With all this in mind, let's move on to our six different Punnett squares. The first pairing we have is horned X'd horn. Both parents are homozygous for the horned allele. Because the horned allele is recessive to the polled allele, if they are horned, you automatically know that they are homozygous for the horned allele. This pairing will produce 100% horned offspring, as you cannot get polled offspring from two horned goats. If you do get polled offspring, I highly suggest doing a DNA test to confirm that there was no mix-up in the breeding plans. Keep in mind that kids in the same litter can have different sires. In addition to that, sometimes kids, particularly doelings, can take a longer time to develop horn buds than expected, which is why I recommend watching my video on how to tell whether a kid is horned or polled at birth. This kidding season, I actually had one doeling, who was only about 2.5 pounds at birth, take 4 weeks before she developed horn buds. I knew she had to be horned because both parents were horned, and in addition to that, the structure of the hair on her head showed that she was horned, not polled. It took a long time for them to come in, but eventually they did. If a kid from this pairing is indeed polled and the parents are correct, look into the pedigree to see if the goat in question had a polled parent, and therefore had a possibility of being polled, as sometimes polled kids can be disbudded and registered as such on accident. The second pairing is a heterozygous polled goat crossed with a horned one. This pairing should result in 50% of the offspring having a genotype of capital P / lowercase p, meaning they are heterozygous for the polled allele, and the remaining 50% have a genotype of lowercase p / lowercase p, meaning they are horned. Keep in mind that this 50% does not always split evenly within a litter. For example, one of our polled does bred to a disbudded buck in 2022 had triplets. All three were polled. Another polled doe bred to a disbudded buck had two kids, both of which were horned and had to be disbudded. This 50-50 ratio is based off of having a large sample size. This next pairing is a homozygous polled goat bred to a horned one. For those of you that are familiar with the relationship between polled-to-polled breedings and intersex goats, you'll probably correctly notice a huge red flag with this pairing, particularly the existence of a homozygous polled goat. I will discuss this more with the next pairing, but for the sake of knowing the genetics, a homozygous polled goat crossed with a horned one will give 100% polled offspring. These offspring will be heterozygous for the polled allele with a genotype of capital P / lowercase p. The next pairing is a heterozygous polled goat bred to a heterozygous polled goat. As mentioned before, this pairing is one that is highly frowned upon by breeders, scientists, and veterinarians alike. This is because studies show that breeding two polled goats gives an increased chance for the offspring to be intersex or hermaphrodites due to the relationship between the polled and intersex genes. This pairing will not guarantee that the offspring will be intersex. However, there is an increased chance. In this pairing, 25% of offspring should be homozygous for the polled allele, 50% should be heterozygous for the polled allele, and the remaining 25% will be homozygous for the horned allele, meaning they will be horned. Keep in mind that you will not be able to tell the homozygous polled kids apart from the heterozygous polled kids without test breeding when they are older. The fifth pairing is a homozygous polled goat crossed with a heterozygous one. Again, this pairing is also a huge red flag, as it has a higher risk of producing hermaphrodites. In this pairing, 50% of the offspring should be homozygous for the polled allele, and 50% should be heterozygous for the polled allele. 100% of the offspring will be polled. Again, you will likely not be able to tell whether the kids are homozygous or heterozygous for the polled allele without test breeding them when they are older. And lastly, the sixth pairing is a homozygous polled goat bred to a homozygous polled goat. Again, this pairing is also a huge red flag and might have the highest chance of producing intersex offspring compared to the other, but will result in 100% homozygous polled offspring with a genotype of capital P / capital P. And that wraps up this video on the genetics of polled goats. All in all, polled genetics are fairly simple, and not having to disbud kids because they are polled is a huge bonus. If you're considering getting and breeding polled goats, I highly recommend watching my video on how to tell if a goat is polled at birth to avoid accidentally disbudding a polled kid. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope this video will help clear up any confusion regarding the genetics of polled goats.